Our fourth contribution today is an address from Minister Gwede Mantashe of the Department of Mineral Resources and Energy. And I'd like to invite our technical team to then cue this video sharing.
Program Director, Archbishop Daumakhoba, Patron of Marikana, Renewal, Mampele, family of Marikana victims, Jerry Vilaka as the Chairperson of Social and Ethics Committee, members of Sibanye-Stillwater Board, Neil Froneman, CEO, fellow mine workers. We convene under extraordinary circumstances to honor those who perished on the tragic day of 16 August 2012. It is worth of note and regrettable that government officially participated in the commemoration of this tragic event for the first time after 9 years. We are, however, humbled by this gesture. To us, commemorative occasion is double-edged sword. Firstly, it reminds us of an unfortunate, regrettable event in our past which must never repeat itself. And second, it implores us to strive for higher ideals amplified by the text and spirit of our transformative constitution. This occasion puts into sharp relief the societal expectation regarding the exploitation of mineral resources. The tectonic shift in paradigm emphasizes the notion that mining policies should go beyond the frontiers of legal compliance to meet societal expectation. It is in this context that the changes in the governance of natural resources have expanded the range of stakeholders in the management of natural resources. The result of this shift has been the establishment of a social partnership between the state, the private sector, and the civil society. It is now common to see embodiment of the elements of social license being part of the law, thus amplifying the voices of the affected communities in the mineral governance. The mining charter, in addressing the misfortunes of our past mineral governance, wherein the involvement of communities and workers was not well articulated, the 2018 mining charter recognizes this prism by ensuring that communities and workers do not only participate in the exploitation of mineral resources as purveyors of cheap labor, but also equity owners. Towards this end, the current mining charter implores mining companies to give at least 5% free carried interest to communities. It also implores on them to give at least 5% free carried interest to workers. In this way, mine workers can benefit from the exploitation of mineral resources beyond wages. The charter has further ensured that this benefit is not subjected to any reduction by the mining right holder through the issuing of new shares. The 5% equivalent of issued shares capital for the benefit of host communities shall be administered at no cost by a trust or similar vehicle. What is important to note here is that the trust must comprise of representation of host community members, including community-based organizations and traditional leaders. However, the charter will only have effect if it is implemented by the mining company, monitored by the department. In this regard, the department has identified compliance monitoring as one of the priority areas that need to be strengthened. Together with other social justice-oriented policies that are embedded in the MPRDA, like the social labor plans, communities are poised to meaningful benefit from the exploitation of natural resources, which are national patrimony and heritage of all South Africa. As the department would like to enjoy mining commerce to give effect to the socio-economic and social justice-oriented tenets of our policy. It is only in the context of harmonious coexistence between communities, workers, and mining companies that mineral resources can be optimally and orderly exploited with the disturbance. This is the social capital in which all relevant stakeholders must invest. Thus, it is for this reason that the department will henceforth rigorously monitor the implementation of this policy. The charter requires that right holders contribute meaningfully towards mining community development. Mining rights holders thus must, in consultation with relevant municipalities, mining communities, traditional authorities, affected stakeholders, identify developmental priorities of mine communities. These projects must therefore be aligned to the IDPs and be identified in the social and labor plan. We need to have new approach to social and labor plans. The charter makes provision for collaboration of mining rights holders operating in the same area to identify projects and maximize socio-economic developmental impact in line with approved social and labor plans. The charter further requires a 100% implementation of the social labor plan projects within any given financial year. This will result in impactful projects that will make a difference in communities. However, these social labor plans should not replace municipal integrated development programs, but must complement them. Furthermore, the introduction of the district development model will enhance collaboration among the stakeholders and across sectors to effectively address the socio-economic challenges faced by communities. Mining communities like Marikana can best benefit from this support. The department has from time to time entered into various contractual agreements with mining companies. These agreements are meant to give practical effect to the socio-economic objective of the MPRDA. As a result, we have seen the building and refurbishment of, among others, community health care centers, schools, and roads. We have recently visited Mpumalanga, for instance, to officially open two state-of-the-art health care facilities in Middleburg and Kethiwit, which were built by mines and handed over to community. We expect all mining companies, including Sibanye-Stillwater, to follow suit. In this regard, we are in the process of fast-tracking the assessment and approval of social labor plans requested for Western Platinum and Eastern Platinum pearls. The department has made it its priority to ensure that South African mineral resources are increasingly beneficiated in our country. This will serve to increase the value of our export earnings and internalize job opportunities in the downstream of our mineral value chain. As government, we'll continue improving the regulatory environment of the mining and energy sectors to enable more vibrant and cost-effective sectors to doing business and attract investment. Among this has been the recent promulgation as law of the provision of embedded electricity generation from 1 megawatt to 100 megawatts. Allow me to reiterate that our people have high expectations from both government and established private sector, particularly mining. They have legitimate expectation to claim the mineral resources theirs, and the evidence of which must reflect in their improved living condition. Both the Freedom Charter and our Constitution amplify these high expectations as a legitimate and a duly attainable. The MPRDA further lays the legal basis for their implementation. It is therefore incumbent upon both government and Sibanye-Stillwater to accelerate the realization of these social justice-oriented goals. I take this opportunity to express my profound gratitude at the efforts by other stakeholders such as 16-8 Memorial Trust for tirelessly working, inspired by no motive for gain, to help galvanize the legacy of Marikana tragic events into a program that inspires hope. Also not to be forgotten are the noble efforts of government in all the three spheres, traditional leaders and NGOs, who continue to espouse the values of the kind of special of society that we must all strive for. As I conclude, it is my belief that though a painful past, tomorrow holds promise of a better life for all our people when we work together in the spirit of national reconciliation and nation building. I therefore invite all members of the Marikana community, as well as other communities around the country, to embrace the kind of national solidarity that must forge the nation we collectively aspire to. Let me thank you for this opportunity.